Hello friends, in this video we are going to talk about one of the standards that is defined by IEEE for wireless metropolitan area network, and that is IEEE 802.16 standard. In this we are also going to cover the various advantages and features provided by the same standard. So let's begin with the topic. Wireless metropolitan area network is basically a network which provides wireless communication within an area that covers a city, and that's why it is called as metropolitan area network. Now let's talk about a standard defined by IEEE 802.16 for wireless metropolitan area network. Wireless metropolitan area network, that is WMAN, is a certified named by IEEE 802.16 that functioning on broadband for its wireless metropolitan. That means it provides a wireless connection by using a RF signal to an area that covers a city. Wireless MAN have an air interface and a single carrier scheme in order to operate in the frequency range of 10 to 66 gigahertz spectrum, and it supports increasingly unreliable transfer level at many certified frequencies. The wireless MAN basically opens doors internet access to a business subscribers. Wireless MAN can handle thousands of user stations with prevent collision and support legacy voice system, voice over IP and TCP. So these are the functions, or these are the application in which we can use a wireless metropolitan area network. It offers different application, and based on that different application, the different QoS is get provided to the user. The technology of wireless MAN consists of ATM, FDDI and SDM, and WiMAX is basically a term that is used for wireless metropolitan area network, and it is given or it is defined by IEEE 802.16 standard. So basically, IEEE 802.16 standard provides a wireless computer network access and internet access for the metropolitan area network, and therefore acts as an alternative to a cable, DSL and TI offering. So here we can say, when we compare wireless network with the wired network, so in case of MAN, the standard defined by IEEE, that is 802.15, provides an alternative method for a traditional cable network. 802.16 provides a flexible, then cost-effective, standard-based, means filling a gap in broadband services not covered in the area of wired communication. So those applications in which we cannot use a wired medium, in that application we can use a wireless metropolitan area network, as it provides more flexibility, higher data rate, high security as compared to wired network. The advantage of the system based on 802.16 are multifold. Faster provisioning of services even in the areas that are hard for wired infrastructure to reach, lower the installation cost, and ability to overcome the physical limitation of the traditional wired infrastructure. So by using a wireless network, it is possible to develop a network in the region where it is difficult to implement the wired network. Also, it provides a low cost of implementation, then it provides a ability to overcome the physical limitation. Sometimes in the remote areas, it is not possible to deploy a wired network. So in that case, we can use a wireless network as an alternative. Thus, 802.16 based system provides the affordable last mile broadband access for millions of subscribers in home and business throughout the world. So because of this flexibility, low maintenance cost, low implementation cost, and in order to overcome the limitations of infrastructure and network deployment, the wireless metropolitan area network, which is also called as WiMAX or 802.16 standard, is provides last mile connectivity or last mile broadband access to many of the users throughout the world. Now let's move to the history of 802.16 standard, that is nothing but roadmap of IEEE 802.16 standard. In 2001, 802.16 standard was originally designed for 10 to 66 GHz frequency spectrum. It specified medium access control MAC and physical layer for air interface for a fixed broadband wireless access system with a line of sight propagation. Then in 2003 of January, IEEE 802.16a standard comes into the picture, which was an extension of the original version, that is 802.16, and it covers a frequency band between 2 to 11 gigahertz and enable non-line of sight operation. So in case of 802.16 standard, which was the original version in which the line of sight is required for performing the operation, whereas the extended version or the extension version, that is 802.16a, the non-line of sight operation enabled the mounting of base station on the roof of home or building rather than towers or mountains. Trees and buildings were no longer an obstacle. In case of line of sight, the mountains, trees considered as an obstacle between the signal, because if the obstacle comes in between the path of the signal, the communication is get lost or the data is get lost. So the new version or the higher version or extended version of IEEE 802.16a, in which we can implement the antennas on the home rooftop, or we can implement the antennas on the building rooftop rather than mounting it on the mountains or trees. And in this case, the mountains and trees are not considered as an obstacle for the signal transmission. The range of operation is increases up to 30 miles, and the non-line of sight performance and throughput are optimal in typical cell radius of 4 to 6 miles. The 802.16a introduced a three physical layer, and they are nothing but OFDM, that is orthogonal frequency division multiplexing, OFDMA, single carrier, and it also introduced the additional MAC function and MAC topology or mesh topology support. Then IEEE 802.16a also provides the wireless backhaul technology for connecting the IEEE 802.11 wireless LAN and commercial 802.11 hotspots with the internet. So 802.16a basically provides a, or it supports a backhaul applications in which the single subscriber do not have an ability to subscribe a leased line for providing access to the broadband services. Then it provides a backward compatibility so that we can use 802.11 wireless LAN devices and services in conjunction with 802.16a standard, and we can connect the commercial 802.11 hotspot with the internet. Then in July 2004, the next standard comes into the picture, and that is nothing but 802.11. Then in July 2004, the next standard comes into the picture, and that is nothing but 802.16D, and it is a combination of 802.16 and 802.16A with some modification to MAC and physical layer. Then in 2005 of December, 802.16e comes into the picture and was an amendment to the 802.16d. It had MAC modification for the limited mobility. So in case of 802.16e, uses OFDM, in which carrier are get divided between the user to form a sub-channels. The coding and modulations are adapted separately for each sub-channel. As the carriers is get divided between the number of users, therefore different coding methods are used for different sub-channels. SOFDMA is basically considered as an enhancement of OFDMA that scales the number of subcarriers in the channel with the possible values of 128, then 512, then 1224 and 2048. Then the IEEE 802.16e includes a power saving and sleep mode so that it is possible to consume less power and it is possible to save more power, and therefore it extend the battery life if it is a mobile device or portable device. IEEE 802.16e also supports a hard and soft handoff to provide user with a seamless connection as they move across the coverage area of the adjacent cell. In case of mobile communication, when the user moves from one cell to another cell, because of the handoff, it is possible to make a continuation of the call, or it is possible to provide a seamless continuity to the user. So here in case of IEEE 802.16e standard provides hard and soft handoff so that a seamless connectivity is maintained for the user when it moves from one cell to another cell. So this is what basically the history, or we can say the roadmap of IEEE 802.16 standard, which starts from 2002 to 2004, then 2006, and the standard we come through 802.16. Then the extension is get developed, that is 802.16A, then 802.16D, which is a combination of A and 102.6, and then 802.16D and 802.16E comes into the picture. Now let's understand what basically the WiMAX technology is. The standard for WiMAX technology is a standard for wireless metropolitan area network that has been developed by a working group number 16 of 802 IEEE. So it is basically a standard that is defined for wireless metropolitan area network, and the standard having a number 16 for IEEE 802, and therefore the standard is called as IEEE 802.16 standard, which is nothing but WiMAX. It basically specialized in point to multipoint broadband wireless access. As we know, there are two different types of wireless network topology, that is point to point and point to multipoint. The point to multipoint provides more advanced features, since we can say that it provides more proper connection and more advantages as compared to point to point connection. And therefore, WiMAX is defined for point to multipoint broadband wireless access. Initially, 802.16 was developed and launched, but now it has further refined. So as the development is going on into the wireless field, the variations in the IEEE 802.16 standard is also get developed. 802.16D and 802.16, which was released in 2004, was released as a refined version of 802.16A standard aimed at the fixed application. So the variations in the versions or variations in the standard results into the supporting of various applications supported by IEEE 802.16 standard. The another version of standard is 802.16E or 802.16/2005, also released and aimed at roaming and mobile market. So this standard basically provides or support the soft and hard handoff, because of which it is possible for the user to have a continuous connectivity even if it moves from one cell to another cell. So because of these features, the standard, that is 802.16E and 802.16/2005, are mostly widely used in the mobile applications. WiMAX broadband technology uses some key technologies that enable it to provide the high speed data rate to the user. So it provides a very high speed data rate to the user and therefore allow the broadband internet access to the user. The WiMAX uses OFDM, that stands for Orthogonal Frequency Division Multiplexing, and it is used along with the WiMAX technology for enabling to provide high speed data without a selective fading and other issues of other form of the signal format. So this is basically the modulation technique is used by WiMAX technology for providing high speed data rate. So it is basically a form of signal format that uses large number of closely spaced carrier that are each modulated at the low data stream. The close spaced signal could normally expect to interfere with each other, but in case of orthogonal frequency, the signals are orthogonal to each other and therefore there will be no mutual interference occurs in the signal. When the signals are placed very close to each other, the signal get affected by each other or they interfere with each other. But when they placed orthogonally or perpendicular to each other, then there will be no mutual interference between the signal. The data rate to be transmitted is shared across all the carrier, and this provides efficiency against selective fading for multipath fading effect. Then the WiMAX also uses a technique which is called as multiple input multiple output, or in short it is called as MIMO. So it uses a multipath propagation by using a MIMO. That means the signal can be transmitted to multiple point at the same time by using a central location, and for transmission of this signal the WiMAX uses a technology that is called as multiple input multiple output system. By utilizing the multiple signal path that exist, the use of MIMO either enables the operation with the lower signal strength level or it allows for higher data rate. So with the help of MIMO, it is possible to provide the higher data rate, and also it is possible to provide the signal to the multiple channel with the low signal strength. MIMO is a form of antenna technology that uses multiple antennas to enable the signal traveling via a different path as a result of reflection to be separated, and capability used to improve the data throughput and or the signal to noise ratio, and therefore improving the system performance. So basically, multiple input multiple output is nothing but the advanced technology of the antenna, and because of this technology it is possible to improve the maximum data transfer rate, that means the maximum throughput of the system, and therefore the overall performance of the system is also get improved. So we can say WiMAX is one of the hottest broadband wireless access technology in the world today, and WiMAX systems are expected to deliver the broadband access services to the residential and enterprises customer in an economical way, as they provide high data transfer rate at low cost. Therefore, it is considered as a more low cost option or more economical option for the enterprises and customers. WiMAX is standardized wireless version of Ethernet, intended primarily as an alternative to a wired technology such as cable modem, DSL and even T1 links to provide broadband access to the customer premises. So we can say it is basically used for providing a broadband access to the customers, and it acts as an alternative to the wired connection. So where we can replace the cable modem, we can replace the DLS by using a WiMAX. WiMAX is an industry trade organization formed by leading communication component and the equipment companies to promote and certify capability and interoperability of the broadband wireless access equipment that conforms to the IEEE 802.16 and ETSI Hyperman standard. So basically, it is a standard developed by the various industries and the manufacturing equipment manufacturer, as well as it is basically developed for promoting the equipment that can have the compatibility and interoperability between the 802.16 standard devices and ETSI Hyperman standards. Now, when we compare Wi-Fi with the WiMAX, the operation wise they work similar, but at the higher speed over the greater distance and for greater number of users. So Wi-Fi having the disadvantage of covering less area and provide less data transfer rate as compared to WiMAX, where WiMAX covers a large area and it provides large data rate as well as it supports large number of users. WiMAX has an ability to provide a services even in the areas which are difficult for wired structure to reach and the ability to overcome the physical limitation of the traditional wire infrastructure. So in some of the area it is difficult to implement a network by using a wired medium, and in that case we can use a WiMAX as a cost effective solution, as it requires less cost of implementation and less time for setting up the network. WiMAX was formed in April 2001 in anticipation of the publication of the original 10 to 66 GHz IEEE 802.16 specification. WiMAX is 802.16 as the Wi-Fi alliances is to 802.11. So we can say WiMAX is basically a short form of worldwide interoperability for microwave access. It is a baseband technology used for providing wireless access to the metropolitan area network. A wireless technology optimized for the delivery of IP-centric services to the wide area. A scalable wireless platform for constructing alternative and complementary broadband network. So by using a Wi-Fi, it is possible for the user to have an internet access and also to have a wireless platform, and it acts as an alternative to the wired medium. Basically, the IEEE 802.16 working group develops a standard that addresses two types of usage model, and the models are a fixed usage model that is developed by a standard called as IEEE 802.16-2004, and the second is portable usage model that is defined by IEEE 802.16e. So here we can say why Max is basically a simple term that is used by the people instead of using IEEE 802.16 standard, and the technology themselves, although it applies only to the system that meets the specific criteria for the WiMAX forum. The 802.16a standard, which was defined for the frequency range of 2 to 11 GHz, is a wireless metropolitan area network technology that will provide a broadband wireless connectivity to the fixed, portable, and nomadic devices. So irrespective of whether the device is fixed, whether it is portable, the 802.16a standard provides a frequency range of 2 to 11 GHz to a services. So WiMAX can be used to connect 802.11 hotspot to the internet, as it provides a backward compatibility, it provides a campus connectivity, and provides a wireless alternative to the cable DSL for last mile broadband access. So with the help of backward compatibility, it is possible for the 802.16a standard to provide the last mile connectivity, to provide the alternative option, or we can say the alternative to the cables or DLS with the help of 802.16a standard. Now let's understand why there is a need of standard that is called as WiMAX. The WiMAX basically satisfied the variety of the access needs, that means which includes the external broadband connection, then it includes the filling of gap in the cable and DSS, which basically acts as an alternative to it. So because of this, it is important to develop a wireless infrastructure, or we can say a wireless network, that is called as WiMAX. So basically WiMAX satisfied the variety of the access need. The potential application includes extending broadband capabilities to bring them closer to the subscriber, so that user can have the various services and various applications for the use, filling gap in cable, DSL and TI services, Wi-Fi and cellular backhaul, providing last 100 meters access from fiber to the curb, and giving service provider and another cost-effective option for supporting the broadband services. So as the WiMAX provides low-cost solution for providing high data transfer rate, therefore it is also suitable for the service provider to provide the various type of broadband services to the user at the cost-effective manner. Then the another parameter, or we can say the another requirement which satisfied by the WiMAX, is nothing but the bandwidth solution. So basically the Wi-Fi provides a very high bandwidth solution, where a large spectrum deployment, which is basically greater than 10 megahertz as desired using existing infrastructure, and at the same time the cost is down while delivering the bandwidth needed to support the full range of high value multimedia services. So as we know, it provides a very cost effective solution to the subscriber as well as to the service provider. Therefore, even if it provides a higher bandwidth, the cost required for the deployment of the network is still less. WiMAX can help service provider to meet many of the challenges they face due to the increased customer demand without discarding their existing infrastructure investment, because it has the ability to seamlessly incorporate across the various network type. So as the demand of services, or as the demand from the customer is get increases, based on the demand of the customer, it is important for the service provider to change the infrastructure. But changing of entire infrastructure results into the high cost investment, which is not possible every time. So by using WiMAX, it is possible for the service provider to fulfill the various demands of the subscriber without actually changing the existing infrastructure of the subscriber, as the WiMAX provides the facility to operate or to provide the backward compatibility. Therefore, it is possible for the subscriber as well as the service provider to use these types of network. Then moving towards the quality of service and moving towards the area coverage, the WiMAX, as it is a nothing but wireless metropolitan area network, so it provides a wide area coverage and quality of service capability for application ranges from real-time delay sensitive voice over IP to a real-time streaming video and non-real-time downloads, ensuring that the subscriber obtain the performance they expect from all other types of communication. The quality provided by the WiMAX is independent of whether it is real-life application or whether it is real-time application or non-real-time application. The WiMAX provides a very better quality of service to the user as compared to other type of communication. Also, the coverage area provided by wireless network is very much higher, as it is nothing but wireless metropolitan area network. WiMAX, which is an IP-based wireless broadband technology, can integrate into both wide area, third generation mobile, and wireless and wireline network, allowing it to become a part of seamless anytime, anywhere broadband access solution. As it is an IP-based wireless broadband technology, therefore we can integrate it with the mobile network, which is of 3G network, and we can integrate it with wireless and wireline sort of network so that it can provide a seamless access irrespective of the location of the user or irrespective of the position of the user. It provides a seamless or continuous broadband access solution. WiMAX is intended to serve as the next step in the evaluation of 3G mobile phones via a potential combination of WiMAX and CDMA standard, which is called as 4G. So these are basic some requirements that are get fulfilled by the WiMAX, and therefore there is a need of WiMAX comes into the picture, as it provides higher data rate at low cost. At the same time, it provides the backward compatibility. At the same time, it provides higher bandwidth even at the low cost. It fulfills the requirement of the service provider to meet the demands of the subscriber for the new applications and services without any change in the existing hardware or without any change in the existing infrastructure. So because of this, the WiMAX is gaining popularity amongst the subscriber as well as the service provider. Now let's move on to the various features provided by WiMAX. So the WiMAX is wireless broadband solution that offers a rich set of features with full of functionality and full of flexibility in terms of deployment option and potential service offering. Some of the features are, basically there are two types of services that are provided by WiMAX, and they are non-line of sight service and line of sight service. So let's discuss what is non-line of sight service, which is called as NLOS, and line of sight service, which is called as LOS. So non-line of sight service is a Wi-Fi sort of service. So now here, a small antenna on the computer is used to connect to the WiMAX tower, and in this mode the WiMAX uses low frequency range, that is from 2 gigahertz to 11 gigahertz, which is similar to Wi-Fi. So we can say non-line of sight is somehow similar to Wi-Fi only, where line of sight service, here the fixed dish antenna points straight at the WiMAX tower is required, and the antenna is mounted either on the rooftop of the subscriber or it may be on the pole. The line of sight connection is stronger and it is more stable, as it makes a direct contact with the tower and it's able to send a lot of data with the few error. Line of sight transmission uses higher frequency range, and the maximum possible frequency range is of 66 gigahertz. So these two types of services are basically provided by the WiMAX standard. Now the next feature related to the WiMAX standard is nothing but OFDM based physical layer. Here OFDM stands for orthogonal frequency division multiplexing. In case of OFDM, the channels are very closely spaced to each other. But when the channels get closely spaced with each other, then there will be a possibility of the interference. But in case of OFDM, the channels are orthogonal to each other, and therefore there will be no interference occurs between the signal. So a WiMAX physical layer, which is called as PHY, is based on the orthogonal frequency division multiplexing scheme that offers a good resistance to the multipath and allow WiMAX to operate in non-line of sight operation or non-line of sight condition. So as there is no interference because of the orthogonality between the channel, therefore the system, or we can say the physical layer, offers a good resistance to the multipath, or we can say the fading effect, and it allows WiMAX to operate in non-line of sight applications. Then the next feature supported by WiMAX is nothing but very high peak data rate. The WiMAX is capable of supporting the very high peak data rate. In fact, the physical peak data rate can be as high as 74 Mbps when operating with a frequency of 20 MHz wide spectrum. Now, more typically, when uses 10 MHz spectrum operating scheme by using TDD scheme, then and if it uses 3:1 downlink uplink ratio, the peak physical data layer data rate is about 25 kbps and 6.7 mbps for the downlink and the uplink respectively. So for uplink, the WiMAX provides a data rate of 25 kbps and for downlink it provides the data rate of 6.7 mbps. The next feature is nothing but scalable bandwidth and data rate support. So WiMAX has a scalable physical layer architecture, and because of it, it allows the data rate to scale easily with available channels of bandwidth. For example, a WiMAX system may use 128, 512 or 1048 bit fast Fourier transform based on whether the channel bandwidth is 1.25 MHz. Or 5 MHz and 10 MHz, as we are using three different types of fast Fourier transform having a bits of 128, 512 and 1048. Therefore, it uses a channel bandwidth of 1.25 MHz, 5 MHz and 10 MHz. Now, this scaling may be done dynamically to support a user roaming across the different network that may have the different bandwidth allocation. So, depending upon the user position or depending upon the location of the user, the scaling is required to be done, or the scaling of bandwidth is required to be done by the WiMAX system. The next type of feature is nothing but AMC, that stands for Adaptive Modulation and Coding. The WiMAX supports the number of modulation and forward error correction, that is FEC coding technique, and allow the technique to be get changed as per the user's requirement and performance of the network and based on the channel condition. AMC, that is Adaptive Modulation and Coding, is considered as an effective mechanism for maximizing the throughput in a time variable signal. Then the next feature that is provided by the WiMAX is nothing but link layer retransmission. The WiMAX support automatic retransmission request, which is called as ARQ, at the link layer for the connection that requires enhanced reliability. So when there will be any data loss occur, or when the error data get received by the receiver, then in that case WiMAX generates automatic retransmission request, which is called as ARQ, at the data link layer. The ARQ enabled connection requires each transmitted packet to be acknowledged by the receiver. Unacknowledged packets are assumed to be lost and retransmitted. Therefore, the receiver requires to send an acknowledgement every time whenever it receives the data packet. If the receiver fails to send an acknowledgement, then it is assumed by the transmitter that the data packet are get lost, or the data packets get caused by or attacked by error, and therefore the retransmission or the automatic retransmission request is get generated at the data link layer. Then the next is nothing but support for TDD and FDD, which stands for time division demultiplexing and frequency division demultiplexing. IEEE 802.16 2004 and IEEE 802.16E developed in 2005 supports both time division demultiplexing and frequency division demultiplexing, as well as they also supports the half duplex frequency division demultiplexing, which allows low cost implementation of the system. WiMAX uses OFDM is considered as one of the important feature of the WiMAX, where OFDM stands for orthogonal frequency division multiplexing, as a multiplier access technique. So WiMAX uses OFDM as a multiple access technique, where different users can be allocated a different sub channels of the OFDM tones. Then the next feature is nothing but flexible and dynamic per user resource allocation. Now, both uplink and downlink resources allocation are controlled by the scheduler present in the base station, and capacity is shared among the multiple users on the demand basis using burst TDM frames. Then next is nothing but the support for advanced antenna technique. Previously, the range of the system is depend on the designing of the antenna and manufacturing of the antenna. But nowadays, the advanced technique in the designing and implementation of the antenna increases the range, so that will be not considered as a big issue or big problem in the network implementation. So here, in case of WiMAX, it supports an advanced antenna technique, and it has a number of hooks built into a physical layer design, which allows for the use of multiple antenna techniques such as beamforming, space-time coding, and spiral multiplexing. So by using this advanced technique, it is possible to cover the maximum area by using the WiMAX technology. Then next is very important parameter or very important feature in case of WiMAX or in case of any type of communication system, that is nothing but the quality of service offered by that particular system. So here in case of WiMAX, the WiMAX MAC layer has a connection oriented architecture that is designed to support a variety of application, which includes voice and multimedia services. So WiMAX offer supports for constant bit rate, and it supports a variable bit rate. It supports a real-time and non-real-time traffic transmission. In addition to that, it provides a best effort data traffic. The WiMAX MAC is basically designed for supporting the large number of users using multiple connection per terminal and each having its own QoS requirement. The next feature from a data transmission point of view and consider as an important parameter when we consider any type of network, and that is nothing but the security. So the WiMAX provide robust security. The WiMAX support a strong encryption by using an algorithm called as Advanced Encryption Standard, that is AES, and has a robust privacy and key management protocol. The system offers very flexible authentication architecture based on the extensible authentication protocol, that is EAP, which allows for the variety of user credential, which includes username, password, then digital certificate, smart card, and etc. So basically the security provided by WiMAX include authentication of the user. At the same time, it converts the process of converting the text into a ciphertext by using an encryption, and therefore for that purpose it uses the AEC algorithm. The next type of feature for WiMAX is nothing but IP-based architecture. The WiMAX forum has defined a reference network architecture that is based on all IP platform. All end-to-end services are delivered over the IP architecture or on relying on IP-based protocol for end-to-end transport, QoS, session management, security, and mobility. So these are the basic functions provided by IP-based architecture supported by WiMAX technology. Also, the 802.16 devices or 802.16 standard delivers a high throughput at the long range with the high spectral efficiency, and it uses the dynamic adaptive modulation. Because of this, it is possible for the base station to allow to tread off throughput for the range. Then it provides a, or we can say it supports a flexible channel bandwidth, so to accommodate easy cell planning in both licensed and unlicensed spectrum worldwide. Therefore, it is in case of WiMAX, because of the flexibility channel condition, it is possible to accommodate both flexible as well as licensed as well as unlicensed frequency spectrum. As discussed earlier, it provides the robust security feature as well as the QoS required for providing the or required for fulfilling the certain applications required. Then it supports a services that requires low latency, such as voice and video, because the voice and video are required to be transmitted in real time, and latency, or we can say a delay in this case, is not a considerable or tolerable. So in this case, WiMAX is considered as the best option as it provides a quality of service as required by the user. The 802.16 voice services can either be TDM voice or voice over IP. The privacy and encryption feature are also included to support secure retransmission and data encryption. In case of data security or in case of robust security point, we have covered that WiMAX uses advanced encryption standard protocol or advanced encryption standard algorithm for performing encryption of the data. At the same time, it performs authentication of the user on the basis of various credentials provided by the user, which includes username, which includes various security cards, and many more options. So we can say that it provides more secure communication as compared to other type of communication methods. Applications of 802.16 are cellular backhaul, broadband on demand, residential broadband, and best connected wireless services. So these are the basic applications that are supported by WiMAX standard, and it fulfills the QoS requirement of these applications. The worldwide interoperability for micro access, that is WiMAX forum, is an industrial group which is basically focuses on crediting the advanced technology solution for the high speed wide area network, and in order to provide the high speed wide area internet access and ensures the operability amongst the devices based on 802.16 standard from a different manufacturer, so that there will be interoperability and compatibility between the devices which are developed or which are designed by the different manufacturer. Now the WiMAX, that is a IEEE 802.16 standard, is basically an air interface for a fixed broadband internet or wireless access system, and it is known as IEEE wireless MAN air interface, and it is considered as an emerging technology in order to provide or in order to fulfill the requirements of the user, and it is basically a standard that is suitable for fixed, portable or mobile devices, or we can say the nomadial devices which are present in metropolitan area network. So these standards, which are issued by IEEE 802.16 working group, was originally covered the wireless local loop, that is WLL technology, in the frequency band of 10.66 GHz radio spectrum, which is then extended through a project to include both licensed and unlicensed frequency, that is ranges from 2 to 11 GHz. So currently WiMAX includes 802.16-2004 and 802.16E, in which 802.16-2004 utilizes OFDM for providing the multiple users in time division multiplexing fashion in the sort of round robin technique, but it is done very quickly so that the user have the perception that they are always transmitting and receiving. So delay, or we can say the latency, is very less in case of 802.16-2004 standard. 802.16E utilizes OFDMA, and it can be also used for serving the multiple users simultaneously by allocating a set of tones for each user. Now let's discuss the various versions of WiMAX. So initially it is considered that the new applications for WiMAX have been developed, and as a result there are two flavors of WiMAX technologies which are available. The two flavors of WiMAX technologies are used for the different application, and they are based on the same standard. The implementation of each has been optimized to meet the requirement or to meet the particulars of the suitable or particular applications. So the two different methods are, first of all, 802.16D. It is basically used as a DLS replacement. So 802.16D version is often referred as 802.16-2004, and it is closer to what they termed the original version of WiMAX defined under 802.16. That means the features and the standards and the applications supported by 802.16A is similar to the features and applications supported by 802.16D. It aimed at the fixed application and provide wireless equivalence of DSL broadband data, often called as WiMAX broadband. So here this standard is basically used for replacement of DLS cable, or we can say it is acts as a replacement or alternative of the DLS connection, and therefore it is also called as WiMAX broadband. The WiMAX forum describes the technology as a standard-based technology enabling the delivery of last-mile wireless broadband access as an alternative to cable and DSL. So, WiMAX forum itself define it as it is an acts as an alternative for cable and DSL. It able to provide the data rate of up to 75 Mbps. As a result of it, it is ideal for the fixed DSL replacement application as WiMAX broadband. As it provides a maximum data rate of 75 Mbps, therefore it is suitable for the fixed application. It also enables the user to, it also able to use the user for backhaul, where the final data may be distributed further to individual users. And it covers a area having a radius up to 75 km. The second method, that is nothing, or the second standard, is nothing but 802.16E, and it is basically for the nomadic and the mobile user. While 802.16 or the WiMAX was originally developed for the fixed user, but as the demand of user mobility or as the demand of high data rate at low cost is get increased, the next standard comes into the picture, and that is nothing but 802.16e standard. So it basically provides the requirement of high speed data rate at low cost than the provided by the cellular service. An opportunity for the mobile version was seen and 802.16e was developed. So the requirement of this standard was basically the high speed data rate, at the same time low cost, and second one is nothing but high speed data rate, that means the data transmission rate which is similar to the cellular network. So to fulfill this requirement, 802.16e comes into the picture, and it is, this standard is also called as 802.16-2005 standard. It currently provides an ability for the user to connect the WiMAX cell to the variety of location, and it also supports the variety of features and applications which are required by the user. 802.16e is able to provide data rate up to 15 Mbps, and the cell radius distance are typically between 2 to 4 km. 802.16e provides a feature of soft and hard handoff, in which the user can move from one cell to another cell without losing its connectivity. Therefore, 802.16 provides a seamless connectivity to the user. So this type of feature is get provided by using this standard, which fulfills the requirement of cellular communication or fulfills the requirement of mobility of the user. Now let's have the comparison between 802.16, 802.16a and 802.16e. So the first parameter that we used for the comparison is nothing but spectrum. So 802.16 uses a spectrum of 10 to 66 gigahertz, whereas 802.16a uses a spectrum which covers the unlicensed range, that is 2 to 11 gigahertz, and 802.16e uses a spectrum of 6 gigahertz. Then configuration is nothing but 802.16a do not require line of sight, that means we can say it is non line of sight operation, and also 802.16e comes under the non line of sight operation. Then bitrate provided by 802.16 is nothing but 32 to 134 Mbps by using 28 megahertz channel. Then 802.16a supports a bitrate of 70 or 100 Mbps by using 20 megahertz channel, and 802.16e provides a bitrate up to 15 Mbps. Then type of modulation used in the 802.16 is QPSK 16 QAM and 64 QAM, whereas 802.16a uses 256 subcarrier OFDM using QPSK, and it uses 16 QAM, 64 QAM and 265 QAM, whereas the modulation technique used by 802.16e are similar to the modulation technique used by 802.16a. Then mobility. Here in case of 802.16, it is used for the fixed device, or we can say it is used for the fixed application. 802.16a is also used for the fixed application, whereas 802.16e supports a mobility which is greater than 75 mph. Then channel bandwidth supported by 802.16 is 20 MHz, 25 MHz and 28 MHz. And in case of 802.16a, the channel bandwidth is selectable, and it is having a range of 1.25 MHz up to 20 MHz. And in case of 802.16e, the channel bandwidth is planned, and it is planned at 5 MHz. Next is nothing but the typical cell radius covered by the E standard. So 802.16 covered a typical radius of 1 to 3 mile, 802.16a covers a typical radius of 3 to 5 miles, and it is 1 to 3 mile in case of 802.16e. Then the completion year of 802.16 is nothing but December 2001. 802.16a is get completed in January 2003, and 802.16e is get completed in second half of 2005. So this is how we can compare these three standard by using the various parameters. After discussing the various versions of WiMAX or 802.16 standard, let's find out what are the competitors to a technology. So the competitors with the Why Max 802.16 depends upon the type of version that is being used. Initially, it was thought that there will be a significant competition with the Wi-Fi. There are other areas in which the other competitors comes into the picture in order to provide a competition to the WiMAX network. Somehow we can say that the Wi-Fi and WiMAX are similar to each other, but they get differentiated from each other on the basis of the range that they provide, then on the basis of the data transfer rate that they provide, and on the basis of the power consumption used by them. So we can say the other competitors based on the different application to the WiMAX is nothing but the DSL cable line. The WiMAX is capable to provide the high speed data rate or high speed data rate links to the user, and in this way they can act as a threat to the DSL cable operator. So we can say the DSL cable can consider as a competitor to the WiMAX technology. Then second competitor is nothing but the cell phone operator. As LTE is being developed and initial rollouts were taking place, the cell phone operators saw the mobile version of WiMAX as a significant threat. So it was even considered for adaptation as IMT 4G standard, but LTE was adopted as a standard, leaving WiMAX for the fixed WiMAX broadband, last mile link, and variety of other point-to-point applications. So basically, the WiMAX is suitable for those applications which requires point-to-point communication, or which requires a last mile link, and which requires a fixed WiMAX broadband rather than going for the cell phone operators. Now let's move on to the important parameter or important point of discussion in case of wireless network, that is nothing but the security function provided by WiMAX. So WiMAX were designed at the outset with robust security in the mind. The security provided by WiMAX is very high level security, as it provides authentication, encryption, and for the encryption purpose it uses the advanced level algorithm that is called as AEC, Advanced Encryption Standard Algorithm. Therefore, the security provided by the WiMAX is nothing but the robust security. The standard includes state-of-art method for ensuring the user's data privacy and preventing unauthorized access, with an additional protocol optimization for mobility. So even if the user moves from one area to another area, the security provided to the user or security provided to the user's data is get maintained by the WiMAX. The security is handled by a privacy sublayer within a WiMAX MAC. So in order to provide the security to the user's data, WiMAX uses the various methods. So user data is first encrypted by using a cryptographic technique or algorithm, which provides the robustness to provide the privacy to the user's data. And for that purpose, it uses the algorithm which is called as Advanced Encryption Standard Algorithm, that is AES, and 3DES, that is Triple Data Encryption Standards, are used so that the user data is get converted into ciphertext and privacy of the user data is get maintained. The 128 bits or 256 bits key are used for deriving the cipher is generated during the authentication phase, and it is periodically refreshed for the additional protection. If the number of keys or the number of bits present in the keys are more, then it will be difficult for the attacker to decode or to decipher that data. So as the WiMAX uses 128 or 256 bits of key for performing or for generating the cipher during authentication process, and the keys are get periodically refreshed, therefore it is quite not possible for the attacker to obtain the original data or to hampers the user data. Then the second type of security feature provided by the WiMAX is nothing but device and user authentication. The WiMAX provides flexible means of authenticating subscriber station and user to prevent unauthorized use. The authentication framework is based on the Internet Engineering Task Force, that is IETF EPA, which supports the variety of credentials such as username, password, then digital certificate. It includes smart card and many more things which are required for authentication of the user in order to maintain the user's data security. Then the WiMAX terminal device comes with the building X509 digital certificate that contains a public key, that contains their public key and MAC address. So WiMAX operator can use the certificate for the device authentication and use the username and password or smart card for authentication on the top of the user authentication. So we can say the two-layer authentication is get provided through the device and user authentication. The next type of security feature that is used by WiMAX is nothing but flexible key management protocol. The privacy and the key management protocol version 2, that is PKM version 2, is used for securely transferring key material from base station to the mobile station, and it is periodically get refreshed and it is periodically get reauthorized by using the various keys. And because of that, it is possible to maintain the security of the data. Then protection to the control message is another security feature provided by WiMAX. Now the integrity of the over-the-air control messages is protected by using the message digest scheme. That is, for example, WiMAX uses AES-based CMAC, or it uses MD5-based HMAC for providing protection to the control messages which are transmitted on the air. Then another feature provided by WiMAX, that is nothing but the support of fast handover. To support fast handover, WiMAX allows the mobile station to use pre-authentication by using a particular target base station to facilitate the accelerated re-entry so that it is possible for the user to perform the fast handover. A three-way handshake scheme is supported to optimize the re-authentication mechanism for supporting the fast handover. So re-authentication is get performed at the base station and re-authentication is get performed at the mobile station, and simultaneously preventing the any man in the middle attack. So by using this fast handover and by using the re-authentication process, it is also possible for the WiMAX to prevent a man in the middle attack. So these are the some security features that is provided by WiMAX. Now let's discuss the important organization related to WiMAX, that is nothing but WiMAX Forum. So it is basically a non-profit organization called as WiMAX Forum, and it was formed in 2001. It is having the aim or goal of harmonizing standard testing and certifying the interoperability between the equipment from the different manufacturer. So it is basically an organization which defines the standard for WiMAX communication, or which defines the standard to have the interoperability between the equipment which are manufactured by the different manufacturer. So this standard is basically formed by this organization is basically formed by a equipment and component supplier for supporting 802.16 BWA system by ensuring the compatibility and interoperability between the equipments, which will lead to lower cost chip level implementation. So this organization basically aims to provide the interoperability between the different equipments provided or developed by the different manufacturer, and that also at the lower cost. The WiMAX Forum is doing what Wi-Fi Alliances has done for wireless LAN and IEEE 802.11 standards. So their functionality is somehow similar. They're performing the same way in which the Wi-Fi Alliances is working. WiMAX Forum certified products adhere to the IEEE 802.16 standard and offers high bandwidth, lower cost, broader service appliances or capability than most of the available proprietary solution. So the product which follows the certification provided by WiMAX Forum supports a higher data rate, they supports a low cost, at the same time they provide the broader range of services to the users by using the various solution or by using the various infrastructure. So basically the WiMAX Forum is working on setting up the baseline protocol that allows equipment and the devices for multiple vendors to interoperate with each other, and also provides the choice of equipment and devices from the different suppliers so that they can work with each other in proper way and provide the various services and features to the user. Now there are various members of the WiMAX Forum. The WiMAX Forum has more than 4,000 members from the equipment manufacturer. Then there are members from the semiconductor suppliers. Then various service providers are also members of WiMAX Forum. And membership was recently opened to the content provider. And some of the members are nothing but the companies like Alcatel, AT&T, then Intel, Motorola and Siemens. So these are basically members of WiMAX forum. Now let's move on to the advantages provided by WiMAX. So the first advantage is nothing but multifunctionality, and that multifunctionality is within a WiMAX technology. So WiMAX technology is able to perform the variety of tasks at the time of offering high speed of internet. Then it provides the telephone services. Then it is used for transformation of data. Then it is used for video streaming and voice applications. So these multiple functionalities get provided or supported by WiMAX technology. Then the area covered by WiMAX, as it comes under the, as it is a standard of wireless metropolitan area network, therefore the area covered by WiMAX is comparatively higher as compared to the personal area network and local area network. So WiMAX can operate and provide a coverage for hundreds of users at a time and manage sending and receiving the data at very high speed with the full network security. Then the third advantage provided by WiMAX is nothing but WiMAX infrastructure. The WiMAX infrastructure is very easy to implement and it is very flexible and therefore provides maximum reliability of the network. Now, the moving towards the disadvantage of the WiMAX network, though it provides a high data rate and low cost as well as at the same time it provides the very high coverage, but it has some disadvantages. So let's discuss the disadvantages. So it is basically a power sensitive technology, we can say. That means it highly relies on the strong electrical supports. The line of sight is required in order to make the wireless data communication connection extending over the 6 mile or more, means it is needed for the more distant connection. In case of initial versions of WiMAX, it requires a line of sight. That means if any obstacle comes in between the signal, then the signal connection, or we can say the connection between the transmitter and receiver, is get lost. So we can say it is more basically intended for distant connection, and if you want to extend the connection more than 6 mile, then line of sight requirement requires to be overcome. Then the next disadvantage is related to the bandwidth, as the bandwidth is shared among the users in the given radio spectrum. Therefore, if there are many users present in one sector, then definitely the bandwidth utilization is get increased, and that will result into the low data rate or results into the low speed of the network. The next is nothing but weather condition. The bad weather conditions such as rain or cloudy environment, or we can say the other types of environmental factor, interrupt the signal as it is a wireless communication. Then other wireless equipment can also causes the interference. And next is WiMAX is very power consuming and it is very expensive in case of initial installment or in case of initial installation of the technique. So basically, it is used for the corporate solutions, which is hard and expensive to find the frequencies which are licensed. So the its disadvantage, that is spectral limitation. And in other words, the limitations of the wireless bandwidth, as it is required to be used in the bandwidth spectrum of 6 megahertz, or it is required to be used in the bandwidth spectrum of 10 to 11 gigahertz. So therefore, it is very much difficult to find out the licensed spectrum. Then, for the use in high density areas, it is possible that the bandwidth may not be sufficient to cater to the need of large number of client, driving the cost high. It has less QoS and speed is up to 70 Mbps. So sometime it may possible that the quality of service provided by the WiMAX is get reduced, because as the number of user gets increased, so that will decrease the network performance as it utilizes the more bandwidth. So in case of high density area, the QoS requirement or the QoS provided by the WiMAX is get disturbed. So we can say the WiMAX is basically a very flexible, robust air interface, and it is defined by IEEE 802.16 group. It is similar to the wireless standard known as Wi-Fi, but the similarity is not much more higher. They operate on the same fashion, but the range covered by them or area covered by them, at the same time power consumption and the frequency and cost get differed from each other. The WiMAX physical layer is based on OFDM, which is an elegant and effective technique for overcoming the multipath distortion. Then WiMAX support the various advanced signal processing technique for improving the overall system performance or for improving the overall system capacity. Now this advanced signal processing technique includes the adaptive modulation and coding technique. Then it includes the spiral multiplexing and multiple diversity or multi-user diversity. Then it defines a flexible all IP based network architecture which allows exploitation of all the benefits of IP so that the various services can be available to the user and user can use the advanced features and services. Then it offers a very high spectral efficiency, particularly using the higher order multiple input multiple output solutions. We can say the WiMAX Forum is a industry lead non-profit corporation or organization that is formed for promoting and certifying the compatibility and interoperability of the wireless broadband wireless product used for the WiMAX technology. So the WiMAX Forum certified products are based on the single global standard, that is IEEE 802.16, which enables a complete interoperability. So this is what about the various advantages and various standards supported and provided by IEEE 802.16. So I hope you understand this topic of IEEE 802.16 standard and advantages provided by the same. So thank you very much for watching this video. Stay tuned to Ekeeda. Subscribe Ekeeda. Thank you.